Hello everyone, welcome to CodeSoft. So now let's begin with our MoonStack development journey. So the first step towards any web development journey is HTML. In this video, we'll be talking about what exactly is HTML and how do we use it and code it for developing our websites. So let's get started. Okay. So now the first thing is that what exactly HTML stands for. So HTML means hypertext markup language. Now what is the meaning of these words in this HTML full form? So hypertext, what does it stand for? It means a non-linear text. So basically a non-linear text is a text that contains links in it. So suppose you want to create a website, so that will actually be linked by different web pages in it, right? So an HTML is a source with which we can achieve that. So that is why the text that is present in HTML is a hypertext. Next thing is markup language. So a markup language is a language that is defined using different tags. Now HTML is a language where we'll define everything using different tags for everything, right? So that is why it is called as the markup language. And this is the full form of HTML. So the editor for coding, I will be using this VS Code. You can prefer anyone, but I would suggest you go with VS Code because its features are really good for developing websites. So first go to this explore option and open up any folder where you want to keep all the files of these HTML. So inside desktop, I have created one MoonStack folder. I will be opening that. And over here I have, so let me just, I have already created this HTML folder. Now inside this HTML folder, I will create a file. So this option is used for creating a file. I will name it as index.html. So most of us, the main file that we are having, we name it with index.html, and this is a preferred standard in the industry. So you can also go with that. But anyways, this name does not actually matter. Now starting up, first step in writing an HTML code, we need to specify the doc type of our HTML. So how it goes, so this opening and closing brackets, these actually define a tag in HTML. So anything written between these two brackets will be a tag in HTML. And as we see that this is a markup language, so everything will be written using tags. So this is how we specify a tag. Now the first tag that we need to mention in our code is the doc type tag. So this is how it goes. So if I go like this, so you can see VS Code is very good. It actually gives suggestions that what could be the possible tag that you are using, and we are using the doc type. So this is how we specify a doc type tag using this symbol. Now doc type, what is the use of doc type? So doc type we write in our HTML file to basically specify the browser that which version of HTML we are using, right? And so that is quite helpful for the HTML to load our files properly. After that, we start our main part. So for starting any HTML file, we need to start up with the HTML tag. And so you can see VS Code automatically creates a closing tag for this. So each tag, if it is opened, it should also be closed. So there should be a same closing tag with respect to an opening tag. This is the difference between our opening and a closing tag, that in an closing tag, basically there is a forward slash that is present before the text of that particular tag. Now we have seen what an HTML tag looks like. Now all the code of the HTML file will be present in between these opening and closing of HTML tag. The first tag inside this tag is the head tag. So the head tag basically refers to the metadata of our whole website. So metadata, what is exactly a metadata? Metadata is basically a data that is not displayed on the website, but it actually stores information about the main data that will be displayed in the website. Let's say the title of the website, that will not be displayed on the main part of our website, but it will store the title of our main website. So that means it is the data about our main data. So let's just start up with a title tag. So let's say we give our title to this website as CodeSoft channel, okay, or CodeSoft website. A basic title we have given. So this will be our title inside our head tag. After the head tag, we have the body tag. So all the code, all the major code is written inside the body tag. Everything that is written inside the body tag is actually shown on our main website. Okay, now inside our body, we specify everything, that the content of the website is specified inside this body tag. Okay, so let's see what all tags can be possible inside our body. So the first tag is the heading tag. So obviously when we'll be creating any website, we'll require some headings in that, right? So there are six possible headings in HTML. So, and these are varying with their actually size, text size of each tag. So we have from varying from H1 to H2 to H3 to H4, H5 and H6. So these are the six tags that are possible. And these are all varying in size, with H1 the greatest size and H6 the smallest size. So let's just see each one of them. H1, and we specify some text in it. Let's write quotes of here. And similarly we write H2, okay, and inside also we specify quotes of. And let's just skip some of the H3, H4 and H5 and write H6. So this will actually create three different headings with different size of text. Okay, let's just save the file using command save or control save. Now why I was choosing VS Code over other editor is because it is having very great extensions that actually ease our work. So to run this file, either what you can do is you can copy the path of this file and go on your browser and paste it over there. That will also you can run, but that will not be live because whenever you will do any change, you will have to reload that page. A better thing is you can go to this extension part of the VS Code and type over here live server. Okay, and after typing live server, you will find this extension live server. You just need to install it and enable it. This actually helps you run your file on a live basis. Basically, whenever there will be a change in your file, the page will auto render and auto reload and your new change will be visible. Okay, so for this particular file I will so if you have to use the live server, go to this, right click on this and click on open with live server. Okay, and now you can see our live server is open, and this is actually the three headings that we actually wrote in our body part. So you can see the H1 is quite big enough, H2 is small, and H6 is even smaller than both of the other two, right? So this is about H1, H2 and H6 heading tags. Now the next tag is the P tag. P tag refers to the paragraph text, paragraph tag. So basically if you have to write long paragraphs in your main body, in your main website, you can use the P tag. So let's say Codesoft is a YouTube channel that has a lot of technical stuff. Let's just write some random text in it and I will just do control S and it will auto. You can see it just reloaded on its own and you can see the changes visible. And this is how our basic P tag looks like. So anything you write in P tag will be displayed like this on the main website. So this is about the main basic text, basic tags that we have in our HTML. So there are lots of tags and lots of things in HTML, but I will actually be discussing the things that are useful for your Monstack part and not just HTML part. So HTML is, so basically you will not be actually writing the main HTML in your Monstack. You will be working more on JavaScript, but the need to know basis of HTML I will be discussing in this particular video. Tag and a paragraph tag looks like. So coming back to our presentation, we have talked about the structure of HTML. We have seen some tags. The next thing is an attribute of HTML. So attribute refers to the properties of a particular tag. So there are many tags which are having certain properties that describe the action of a tag. So let's say we want to upload an image onto our website. So there is a tag called IMG for it. Now IMG, if we'll just have this simple tag like IMG, how will our computer know that which image we want to upload? So we need to provide it with a certain path of the image or maybe the link of an image with which it can actually find out which image we are talking about. So we have a source attribute in our HTML that actually refers to the path on which of the image that we want to upload. So for this particular example, I have created a folder images inside our HTML. And I've also added a photo inside that. So inside the source, we actually have to provide the relative or the absolute path of the image. In this case, we can provide the relative path. So if I talk about the path, it will be images, and inside images, the photo, actually the name of the photo. So if I type in here, I write images. So it you can see that VS Code actually gives me suggestions on its own. That is really nice. So now I have given the tag IMG and I have also added a source image of it. So let me save my file. And if I come back to my live server, you can see the image has been successfully uploaded, right? But this looks actually very shabby. and very big, right? So we can actually change the width and height of the image. So these are also attribute of our particular image tag. So this is what I was talking about. So let's change the width of the image and let's set it to, let's say 500 pixels. Similarly, we can change the height to 500 pixels. So now it's actually shortened and it looks a little better than the previous one. So this is what an attribute of a tag refers to, and this is our image tag. So image tag is been done over here. Now so image tag does not require any closing tag because there is no use of closing tag in image. Everything has been handled using the attributes itself, right? Okay, this is about the attributes of a tag. The next thing is lists in HTML. So there are two types of list possible in HTML. One is the ordered list. So ordered list means that there will be numbering given to each list item present in our list. For unordered list, we'll actually have a different type of symbol, that is the bullet symbols for our listing. So let's try both of them. So the UL tag refers to the unordered list. So inside UL, we need to provide the LI tag. So LI tag refers to list item tag. So all the items of the list will be shown here. So let's say, so we also want to give a heading to our list. So let's just give a heading. So heading we can use H3 tag, and let's refer courses uploaded on CodeSoft. Okay, this is our heading of the list, and inside it we can give a list item of, let's say, DBMS course. And similarly, we can add on another list item, that is the Linux course. Okay, this looks fine. Let me save my file and let me go back to my server. So you can see a list item has been created, and inside it there are two list items. Another thing is that we can also write this without using this. So if I don't give an H3 tag, it will already be included in our UL tag. So this heading will be a part of UL. So you can see still it is coming, but it is not bold in type because we have not given a heading type to it. So this is about how we can write an unordered list. Similarly, we can also give an ordered list using the OL tag. And here also we can just, so this part we can copy. So the difference between ordered list and unordered list in tag wise is just UL becomes OL. Inside the things, everything is similar. And this is about list. So moving on, the next thing is how to make a text hypertext. So we have talked in the introduction of HTML that the H refers to a hypertext, and hypertexts are the ones in which it is basically a non-linear text containing links in it. So how we can actually introduce links in our website, we use the anchor tag for that. So let's just use an anchor tag. So anchor tag is an A tag. A refers to anchor. And we can close it like this. So inside this, we need to give an attribute of href. So href refers to the link on which we actually want to reach. So let's say I actually write it as www.google.com. And inside it, what should be the text shown? So let's write it as click me. So this click me will actually act as a hyperlink. And if you see, you can see click me. And it says it cannot get www.google.com. Why is it so? The reason being, we have not added HTTPS in front of it. So we need to also mention that. And this should actually work. So now you can see we have actually been transferred to google.com. So this is how you can actually change your links. You can add links to a website and create a hypertext website or a document, right? Now another thing is in anchor tag is the target attribute. What does a target attribute do? So basically now in our current scenario, you can see that when we click on click me, the new link opens on the same tab of our window, which we do not want. We want this page to be saved and our new link to be opened in a new tab. So for that, what we can do, there is a target attribute, and inside we just need to add dash blank. So this refers, open it in a new blank tab, and if we save that, now you can see what we were loading, google.com. it is actually coming in a different tab. And this is how we can make our text hypertext, and we can use the anchor tag, right? The next thing that we have to discuss is the form tag and its attribute. So let's say you want to add a form to your website. You just need to add this tag or element of form. Inside this, you need to specify input for each element. So let's say we add one input and we add, let's say, three inputs. So one for name, one for email, and one for our password. Okay, so we add three inputs. And another thing is, an attribute of input is type. So type actually refers to which type of content you want inside this input tag. So let's say we want name for the first type, and for the second tag, for the second input, we will add type as email. It gives me the type of email. The next one, we'll add a type of password. So why we are adding this type, we will see in a moment. And another thing, that in the end we have to submit, so we'll add another input, and this time the type will be submit. This will act as a submit button for our form. So now you can see a very simple looking form is present onto our desktop. There are three blank inputs for name, password, and email, and a submit button. So name, in this name you can write anything what you want. So another good thing about email is that, let's say I write anything, okay, let's say I write this thing, okay, and if I try to submit it, what it will say, that our email should include @ in this email address. So when we specify the type as email in the text box of that particular input, we should actually have a logical email in that. Otherwise, this form will not pick it up. So it should have an @ in this for sure. So let's say we have our email as codesoft@gmail.com. And now another good thing is, for why we have added the type of password for our third thing, is that password is a sensitive thing and we do not want to display on our screen. So let's say we type anything and you can see it's not displaying. So this is why we specify the type as password, and this is a clickable button as well for the submit part. Okay, now one thing is that currently we have just created a static form and this will not be displayed, or the data will not be going anywhere. So our form tag actually has two attributes. One is the action attribute and the other one is the method attribute. Okay, so action, inside our action attribute, we actually type the URL where we have to send our information to. So let's say you want to transfer this information onto a different URL, you'll use the action attribute of the form tag. And the method attribute actually refers to the method by which you are sending the information. So let's say you are using the get method or the post method. So these are HTTPS methods, get, post methods, which we will be discussing in the later videos. For now, you can just think that these two methods are actually used for transferring the information or saving the information of a form and sending it to a different location or URL. Okay, so another thing is that this form is coming in a straight line. So if you want, the each input should have a separate thing, you can add a break after each element, and this will actually add a line after, actually print the new element into a new, onto a new line. You can see, so this can also happen. Another attribute of our form is the placeholder attribute. So let's say if you can just just looking at this form, we do not know that which will actually be a placeholder for our name and which will actually be a placeholder for our password. So let's just specify this also. So inside the placeholder, let's write, please enter your name. Okay. And similarly, let's copy this up and paste it for email, and we can mention, please enter your email. In the third part, just mention, please enter your password. Okay, so now you can see that each text box is actually having the placeholder text already written. So now if a new user will actually use the form, he'll know what exactly he has to type in to submit the form. So this is about the placeholder, and this is all about form tag. Now the last thing I want to discuss in this video is the div tag. So div tag is actually used to segregate our code into different parts. Okay, so let's say you want this particular part, let's say this h1 and p tag, inside a single segregation. So you can give a div to it, and you can actually close the div after this. So this part is actually segregated. Similarly, you can add divs to different segments of your code. Now how will this help? One benefit is that your code will look neater and the segregations will be visible. And second benefit is that when we will be styling it, we'll give certain IDs and classes to our divs, which will help us provide similar div, similar styling to each div elements. So we will be talking about that also. For now, you can just see that div tag is used for segregation of your data. And that's all with this video. I hope the concepts of HTML are clear to you. Congratulations on your first website using HTML. Now in the next video, we'll be talking about what is ID, what is a class in HTML, and also we'll start styling these elements using CSS. So that's all with this video. Thank you and keep subscribing.